สวัสดีครับ good day to everyone Asit Piromya here from Bangkok this week or this time I will pause a bit from commenting on Thai politics but will turn my attention and your attention to the European theater where there is war or conflict going onbetween Ukraine and Russia and in a larger picture the conflict between Western Europe and North America on one side and the Russian Federation on the other and I think the role and the position of the security organization namely NATO and Russia in particularAnd I would like to say this in order to help, I think, the evolution of the events a bit. That how come it have come to pass now that Ukraine and Russia are on the war path? What were the reasons or the original reasons of this conflict? I think the conflict is only the tail end.But there must be the original causes. And I think I am a bit in the position to help clarify it a bit. As a former Thai ambassador to Moscow 30 years ago, first at the time of Gorbachev, and later at the time of the Russian leadership under President Yeltsin. And I just want to recall thatI think at the end of the 1980s, at the beginning of the 1990s, there were series of meeting between the then leaders of the Soviet Union, Gorbachev, and the then former president of the United States, President Bush, the senior. And at that time, there were discussion between the two leaders. And what came out of that, of those negotiations was that the Soviet Union,will not oppose to the peaceful reunification of West Germany and East Germany. The Soviet Union would not oppose, which means that the Soviet Union will withdraw its troops from East Germany to allow the unification of the two Germanies. Okay, that's the first one. Then the second one is that Gorbachev said that the Soviet side will also oppose.The continued membership of Germany, the unified Germany, in NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. Okay, with the proviso or with the condition that NATO must not expand eastward towards the Russian or the Soviet border, and the agreement of all of these points.Was being reached between President Bush, the senior, and Gorbachev, the leader of the Soviet Union. And the agreement or the understanding were being held during the Bush presidency. Then the United States had a new president in the name of Bill Clinton. That led to the expansion of NATO organization when NATO welcomed the membership of the Baltic state, Latvia, Estonia, and Lithuania. So that was the first breach of the agreement reached between Bush and Gorbachev by President Clinton. And subsequently, you know, under Bush, the junior, and so on, NATO expanded to includeHungary, Poland, and Czech. Then in the course of the year 2008, I think it was under the presidency of Obama, there was a summit meeting in Bucharest, the capital of Romania, in April 2008, whereby the summit meeting came out with a statement that NATO aims to include Ukraine and Georgia,as new members of NATO. At the same time, Putin has been saying it all along, pleading, in fact, for the Western world under the leadership of the United States to take into consideration the security concern of the Russian Federation. But that went unheeded, and NATO continues to expand. And at the same time, key members of NATO, United States and the United Kingdom in particular, had been providing military assistance to Ukraine. And from the Russian point of view, even interfere in the internal politics of Ukraine to bring down a pro-friendly leadership of Ukraine down and install a pro-Western Ukraine leadership. True or false, but that was the perception of the Russian side. But anyway, Ukraine was being beefed up militarily by United States and United Kingdom and some other European countries who are member both of the European Union as well as members of NATO. So in that sense, I think Ukraine has become a sort of an informal member of NATO without being a formal one. And that is still the wish and the hope and the intention and determination both on the part of NATO organization as well as the Ukraine leadership for Ukraine to eventually become a member of NATO, which would, I think, affect directly the security interests of Russia. Because from the Russian perspective, if NATO were to include Georgia and Ukraine as members, it would mean that NATO military hardware and personnel and so on would be moving to the very border of Russia, right at the door of the Russian Federation. And when you said about NATO troops, from the Russian perspective, is the American soldiers. And I think from the Russian point of view, whether it's Putin or later leaders and so on, the presence of American soldiers in the uniform of NATO would be unacceptable to the Russian Federation and the Russian people, and they will oppose it. And they have shown their displeasure of the continued NATO expansion. And I think the push to have Ukraine become NATO member when they send troops to Georgia, yeah, and subdue the Georgian leadership that wanted to join NATO. At the same time, they also, I think, supported the Russian-speaking Ukraine citizens in becoming fighting for autonomy on the eastern part of Ukraine and so on. And eventually, they went down to annex Crimea in the southern part of Ukraine on the Black Sea, which I think we have witnessed that. But United States and the other leadership of NATO still continue to push for the membership of Ukraine in NATO. And the present leadership of Ukraine keep on saying that Ukraine has the sovereign right to become member of NATO, which is correct from the principle and from the ideals point of view. But from real politics, whatever you do as a country, you have to think about the concern and the reaction of the neighboring countries. So nothing is, I think, could be done unilaterally at will, at wish, and so on, without due consideration to the concerns of the neighboring countries. And the Russian has been saying it all along that Ukraine membership in NATO is unacceptable. It would be affect the vital interest of Russia. But that was not been listened. And I think this was the last stall for Putin. That's why he sent troops into Ukraine a few days ago. And I think fighting could be expanded in Ukraine, and it might spill over into the other neighboring countries. And it might bring about a sort of a direct confrontation between NATO and Russia. One never knows. But should that conflict keep on rising, you know, and develop into a major warfare? Could that be avoided? And I believe that good senses, you know, mindfulness from the Buddhist principle should reign over the leadership of the United States, major members of NATO on the European side, and Russian leadership, that there are still venues for peaceful settlement. And I have been thinking about a few, I think, keywords. First one could be the declaration to have a moratorium on the membership, new membership of NATO for the next 20 years. So NATO will not accept any more applications, okay, to cool down the situation. The second alternative would be for Russia and the United States and other European countries and so on to guarantee the neutrality of Ukraine, okay, and to guarantee also the security interests and the sovereignty of Ukraine. So in that sense, Ukraine does not need to have the umbrella of NATO, and at the same doesn't have to keep on causing displeasure on the part of Moscow or Russia. See? And then I think all the countries, you know, countries in and around Russia, you know, at the near abroad of the Russian Federation and so on, can have a negotiation on economic cooperation in order to bring about prosperity and I think security to the whole of Europe, Western, Eastern and Central Europe and so on. So what is needed now is for the world community and so on to call for negotiations, for diplomatic way of solving the problem. That means that all the antagonists, the conflicting parties and so on have to take one step back and I think review the whole situation. Because one has to be, I think, assured, has to be certain that Ukraine cannot become a member of NATO. That would bring about a perpetual conflict between Russia and the rest of Europe, as well as North America, namely Canada and the United States. So one has to work back from that one, that Ukraine membership of NATO or NATO expansion toward the east of Europe is unacceptable to Russia. Could the Western world and the United States accept that security concern of the Russia? Could there be a sort of a compromise formula? And I think we can, if one were to avoid wars. There is still a venue out for negotiation to take place and to find a sort of a compromise formula for the very existence of Ukraine. One other last point. I think NATO is a product of the Cold War. And the Cold War had ended. There was no more communist world or fortress. The communist countries getting together under the Warsaw Pact. The Warsaw Pact disappeared, but NATO still exists. So NATO is a sort of an anachronism of the past of the Cold War. It has no rationale to continue. It should be dissolved. And I think the whole of Europe can find a new, I sort of a formula or a new platform for security cooperation. There is an organization based in Vienna called the Organization of, I think, European Security, OSCE, Security Cooperation of Europe, OSCE, that could be expanded to be a venue or an organization that could bring in all the European nations together to talk about peace, development cooperation, and peaceful coexistence. So there are, I think, organizations that could, I think, facilitate, you know, the peaceful cooperation and not the confrontation and the distrust this is something that I think we as civilized people and so on have to look for and seek for. I think a peaceful means of living together, but not this confrontational type of attitude. So this is enough for today, but that's what can Thailand do? One last point. I think Thailand could work with the ASEAN fellow member state to push for the peaceful solution for negotiation. And at the same time, I think Thailand would be in the position to provide humanitarian assistance to the refugees and asylum seekers and so on from Ukraine into neighboring European countries like Poland and Hungary. I think Thailand would be in the position to provide ready-to-eat food, canned food and so on, even some basic medicines to Poland, Hungary and so on for them to use this humanitarian assistance from Thailand to help the, the Ukrainian refugees. So we can still contribute to the whole thing and to see peace come back to the European theater as a whole. Thank you very much. ขอบคุณมากครับ